Hello, everybody, and welcome to an episode of I Have Notes. I am one of your hosts, Carrie Shawcross, and I Have Notes is a show where we gather people, groups of people, typically four, and these people, they have a surprisingly long IMDb list, surprising in a couple different ways, but I won't get into it, and we talk animation, we talk the creative process, we talk about the idea of a 26-hour day that I'm ready to pitch. But before I can do that, we need to introduce everybody. With me, as always, is my amazing co-host, Issa Badiola. Hello, Issa.
Thank you, Carrie. That was an amazing introduction.
this is the level that I'm at today.
Yeah, I love it. This is the energy I need.
Yes.
Hi, guys. I'm Issa, and joining me today, we have two super special guests. We always call them special because they are. First, we have wonderful Laura Yates. Hello,
Yay.
Laura. And her cats. We always need the cats.
They will certainly be here. Yeah.
We always need one. And we also have with us Chris Kokinos.
Hello, it's me.
Hello.
I'm here. I'm colorful.
It's Kokinos.
Kokinos.
Kokinos. Yeah, Kokinos. I told Lisa she's allowed to call me Kokinos because that's basically her nickname. But she's the only... And Maggie. Maggie's allowed to, actually.
That's true.
And Carrie.
Maybe Carrie.
Laura?
Yeah, okay. You know what? Everyone here gets a passage. You can call me Kokinos just for today.
Yeah, I was going to say. I was just like, it's just a one-time pass for everyone.
One time, that's it.
But except just for me.
Except for Issa, who gets it every day. 24/7. Or 26.5/7.
Oh! That was a
I'm
great
just saying,
segue.
Hear me out.
Okay.
Okay.
Pitch
obviously, it. Look, there are 24 hours in the day. There's that much time, right? We can't add time to days. That'd be ridiculous. But think about how many times in your day where you're like, okay, I'm going to do this for the next hour. This meeting's going to last for an hour. If we just divided things by 26 instead of 24, those we would still do things for just an hour, but it would be a short amount of time and we would get more things done.
Carrie, I don't like that. I don't like that at all. And you know, it's Sam.
But it also means sleeping more or playing video games more.
No, I don't think that this logic. I don't think this logic makes sense. And before we got started on this, you brought this up.
I think it does.
And Sam very quickly went to, you know, what would Jack Bauer think of any of this? I don't think he'd like it.
I'm pitching like a revolutionary new way of thinking that could like revolutionize humanity. I'll just go ahead and say it, humanity. And the last thing on my mind is people rewatching episodes of fucking 23. TV shows only last 44 minutes anyways most of the time. We don't need more time than that.
So
it's still longer than your hour.
Yeah, we'll make it 44 minutes then. It's fine. What is, okay, hang on. How many? Okay,
oh
hang
my
on.
God. Do it. Do the math.
Times
so wait, so like 60, in theory, Carrie, in theory
divided by 26.
Would we still keep things like an hour length? Like a meeting, would it still be an hour long?
Right. So yeah, every hour would now be 50. Sam's saying it's less divisible. Don't Sam. No, absolutely not. Look, every hour would just be 55 minutes instead. Okay.
I don't like that.
But we would still, if you have an hour long meeting right now, it would still be an hour long, but it'd only be 55 minutes.
I hate this conversion. I hate it so
no,
much.
No, okay. You know what?
What about
that's
what about
a good
like
point.
Massages? Like, if you get a massage, is it now
well,
just
then you
a,
go for
well,
two
you already,
hours?
You already pay for a
that's
50
expensive.
Minute massage, frankly.
That's
okay,
true,
hang on.
Yeah.
You know what? Y'all
Thanks,
are right.
Laura.
We should divide it by more. Okay.
That's expensive 2-hour massage.
If we get made if we had 30-hour days instead, that would be 48. That would be a 48-minute hour.
I don't like this. I don't like where this is going. This is making my brain hurt because this is too much math. Ugh, I make sound effects, Carrie. Jesus.
Okay, you know what?
I'm gonna workshop it.
I think 30. I think 30 is great. It's divisible. 48 is a good round number. It all makes sense. I make perfect sense. Vote for me.
I hate this.
Vote for me in the next 2048. K-Shaw.
2048. 4 day weeks.
Four-day weeks.
Wait, yeah.
26
Yeah, how long's
hour.
The work week if we do this?
Well, I was thinking we would change weeks to be 5 days.
Okay. Bold.
Yeah.
Wait.
Don't think about that
okay,
one too
yeah,
much.
Yeah,
I didn't
no,
either.
No, no, no.
Please, yeah, flesh that out, Carrie.
Don't
egg him on.
Okay. So then, each of the 5 days would need to take on some of the hours from the other two that were losing, so they would get longer, but then the hours themselves would get shorter. I'm hurt. My head hurts.
Carrie.
From just saying this, my head hurts.
Not to reveal what's behind the curtain.
We could just have more
curtain. Weeks in a year. Oh no, Laura! No,
Laura!
No, Laura!
Laura! We're putting
that fucks up birthdays. That fucks up the zodiac.
Who cares about birthdays?
Issa, it's funny. I thought you were just gonna say, "Yo, that's
isn't yours like really soon."
You just like that fucks up a lot of things. That's why it fucks up a lot of things. It's like putting a bunch of Jenga pieces on top of Jello is what we're doing right now. We have Jello at the bottom of this, and we're like, let's put more Jenga pieces on this gelatinous cube and make this really awful logic not sound at all.
Is your birthday really soon?
And my birthday is this Friday, yes. Oh, well, actually, by the time this is out for everyone, it is my birthday.
Birthday episode!
Birthday!
Can I tell you? Go ahead, Chris.
I was going to ask, does this come out on your birthday or the day after?
It'll come out for YouTube, yeah. It'll be on my birthday. It's my birthday. Mm.
Yeah, wish her a happy birthday, YouTube.
Thanks,
get YouTube. On it.
Can I tell you guys a good gift
that we can get you?
A gif.
Oh, were you going to say something, Laura?
Yeah, I have a question. Was it your birthday that Jordan Swears got the infamous fortune cookie, the fortune that we all hated a couple years ago.
So there's a story where we went to eat Dinho and we were all eating in a group, and it was huge. It was one of our big like lunches back in the day before COVID. And Jordan Swears got a fortune cookie, and the fortune was, what was it, Laura? Do you remember verbatim what it was?
I don't. I really wish I did. I just remember being really mad about it.
It was pretty much, in summary, the fortune cookie told Jordan Swears, you are the best person here. And we all got so pissed off.
I mean, I've seen some bad fortune cookies before.
Yeah.
We were so mad because he was just like, guys, I just got the best fortune cookie. And we were like, shut the fuck up.
He's like, no, it's the best one, and you can't do anything about it.
That's exactly what he was like.
He rode that high horse for the rest of the day, maybe even for the rest of the week. I think.
Yes.
Wow.
He would always. He would remind us about it. Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah.
Can I tell you guys a thing that happened today?
Do it.
Of course. This actually kind of can segue into something else that we wanted to talk about, but my SO and I have a history of catching my SO and the presents that they give me completely by accident. No. So how do I put it? Context. They were asking me what I wanted for my birthday, like sincerely wanted.
And what you really, really want.
What I really, really want. Spice Girls MP3. And thank you for laughing, Chris Kikinos.
As soon as he threw the .mp3 out, I'm like, yo, mad respect. You know about some days.
So, LimeWire.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
And I told my SO, I really, really want a piano. And not just like those like, keyboard pianos where you like have that rickety stand and stuff. Like I legit want a piano with a backing on it that has the built-in pedals. Like it can be electric, but I want that piano.
Not like a grand.
Not a grand. No, okay. Not an upright.
Not like a baby grand.
Not a baby upright. Grand. Yeah, okay. Not an upright. Just like a regular electric or an electric piano that's basically for middle class people, right? So thank you for that.
You don't want anyone shopping at Rent-A-Center.
No. Like there's like a Steinway down the road. I'm like, no, I'm not about that life quite yet.
Sure.
That's that high class, that upper class. That's the 1% keyboard that you
can get. Yes, I am very strictly in that like low middle class right now.
And we're in that Yamaha bunch.
Exactly. So I tell my SO about this, and they're like, oh, that's expensive. And I go, yeah, I know, but I've been looking. And then I would like pull it up. And it is expensive, regardless of what piano you get. It's going to be an expensive gift.
Is it, you have to get like, could you give it like a ballpark for somebody who doesn't know?
Okay, so the Yamaha ones that have like the backing in it with a built-in pedal and stuff that are pretty heavy. It's a pretty good like electric digital piano, digital keyboard. Those can go like around $400.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You can find cheaper brands. But if you want that like name brand kind of a thing, because Yamaha tends to be pretty good, or pretty, I guess, mainstream popular, like
They make great keyboards and boats.
And boats.
And motorcycles.
Yeah.
Motorcycles, skis.
That's pretty good.
Yeah. Bass guitars sometimes.
Yeah, true.
Know.
Yeah.
Sure.
And okay, okay.
So I told my SO, I really want this, but if you get it for me, I will kill you.
And so you've guaranteed that they will get it for you now.
That's a tough spot. Yeah, that you
yikes, yeah, big
for
yikes.
A while they were like, will you really kill me? And I go, no, I will probably cry and I'll yell at you and saying I will kill you, but I won't actually kill you. And so today I come out of our, we have a creative meeting, and I come out of it early. I go out into the hallway, into the doorway, and there my SO is like in the middle of pushing the keyboard.
Oh my god.
And then he like looks up at me and they're like, oh, and they like look around, and then they put the vase of flowers that they got for me on the keyboard, and they go, happy birthday. It was like a 2-minute scramble, and
I watched it
in its entirety.
That's so good.
I cried. I sobbed. I am going to cry thinking about it right now. Okay, I just
that's
could
so
not
sweet.
Stop crying.
That's beautiful.
I know. I'm just like, aww. Oh god, I'm so happy right now.
That's beautiful. That's
and
really
you didn't
great.
Kill them.
I didn't kill them. Yeah. After I cried, I like wiped my tears and I went, I'll kill you.
You son of a bitch.
You son of a bitch. I love you, you piece of shit.
I like that. That quick thinking of throwing the vase of like flowers on the top. It's like, I've got it.
Good.
This is what I will use to present this. This is the grand bow for this gift.
When are you going to serenade us?
Maybe soon.
Can you call it serenading if it's a piano? Is that only singing?
Technically, I think you can serenade anyone with any musical instrument, be it vocal or otherwise.
But serenade.
Because serenade's with a guitar too, right?
A piece of music sung or played in the open air. Okay.
Oh, so technically a piano inside is not open air. So
hang on. I have a big problem with this dictionary entry.
Uh-oh.
Comma, typically by a man at night under the window of his lover.
Okay, well.
That's not what I would call a definition.
Listen, Webster's
what's your issue with it, Carrie? I don't understand. Can you explain?
Carrie drinks the respect women juice.
Yeah, man, of course.
No, fuck that. I'm not even trying to respect women. I want to be serenaded sometimes. I want to be serenaded. Serenade me!
Fair enough. That was the direction. That's one direction you can go with that there, Carrie. And I
do respect women also, but
is that only coming second to the fact that you want to be serenaded? Is that what I'm getting from this, Carrie?
Maybe.
There's nothing wrong with this.
Because
fair enough.
That was just
respecting women. I think should come. Theoretically, a top five. You know what I mean? Maybe top three.
Oh, yeah.
Top three.
Wow. Damn, he said top five. I was like, that's a lot of wiggle room. I'm just thinking like number one or two. But okay.
I changed my answer.
Yeah, like no joke. I've been to 3 different websites now, and all of them, part of the main definition.
Have you been to Urban Dictionary yet?
Open air at night as by a lover under the window of his lady. That's we're closing that off way too much, y'all.
Have you been to Urban Dictionary yet?
Have I been to let me do it. Urban, it's probably gonna be like a sex move.
Oh, okay. I like that the word of the day is WAP.
Nice.
Of course it is! Macaroni in a pot.
It's probably because of Ben Shapiro.
Oh yeah,
1,000% it is.
Yeah. Okay, Urban Dictionary. Definition: like to appear in front of your lover's window and sing a song for them late at night.
Give us an example, Carrie, please.
The example that they give.
Ooh. Yeah.
My dad kicked my ass because this drunk stranger serenaded me last night.
Oh, that's sweet. Why can't you serenade during the day? I don't understand.
Why can't you serenade during the day? Why is there an adult man beating, presumably based off all the definitions, his daughter because somebody serenaded him?
Very problematic on all fronts.
Yeah, I'm not liking anything about this.
I think I've frozen.
Hmm.
I'm frozen.
Okay, so maybe Issa, don't serenade us, but you could perform a song for
us. Okay, yeah, yeah. Do that.
Just in case anybody's curious, WAP does stand for wet ass pussy.
Oh my god! Okay. Well,
thank you for doing that, Carrie.
I didn't know at first. I didn't, but I did learn.
Ben
Shapiro.
Oh my god.
Laura, it's a medical condition, okay? I can't believe he said that with his mouth and fingers, I guess.
There's something about that song where even if it's a censored version, it's like even worse than the explicit version. I think it's because of the words that they use to describe it, and suddenly the imagination just goes wild. So I listened to the censored version first. I watched the music video. After that, I spent the next like 2 days singing "There's Some Whores in This House" and terrorizing the household. As a result,
and if there were, you would want to know and maybe alert those around you.
I had definitely tweeted "There's Some Whores in This House," and my SO goes, "Oh my there gosh,
where?
Where?
Where? I didn't where know." Where are they?
And so I watched the music video, and with this, like, you know, fascinating, it's not disgust, but it's like one of those things where you just watch it and you go like, I'm not exactly into this, but there's something really interesting here that I think I should keep watching to find out. And it just had the title WAP, but they said wet and gushy. And for the longest time, I was wondering, what does WAP mean? And then out loud, as I'm playing the video, so my SO hears it and they're at the office, I go, oh, it means this. And it was just a chorus of like, oh yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense. And then we continue about our day. Thank you for listening.
You didn't want to say what this was though.
No, I said it out loud, but not for the podcast at the moment. Do you want me to say
it? I mean,
Carrie's already dropped the ball. Yeah.
It's true.
We only get to say one of those per stream.
I wanted people to know.
In case they didn't.
All Ben Shapiro said was the P word.
Like,
and I didn't.
Can I lay something out here? I'm actually actively still learning Urban Dictionary words that apparently everybody knows. Yes. Like, I learned what himbo was yesterday.
Only yesterday?
Only yesterday.
Nice. Yep.
I mean, Issa. Thank you, I think.
Yeah, it didn't show up when you looked in the mirror.
A compliment. Hey. I'll write that off as a compliment. I'm a big dummy, so it's okay. But yeah, Issa, it goes back to like when we were doing review, and I think I learned shipping from y'all like 2 years ago. Yeah,
that's how I meant it.
I remember this moment. Yes.
Yeah. Laura does, yes.
Do you want the story real quick? Because I can give it to you.
Oh, please. So while you're doing that, Chris, can you tell us what you do?
Sure. So my name is Chris Kokinos. This really hurts my wrist. Ouch. Chris Kokinos, and I am the head of the audio department for Rooster Teeth Animation. So I oversee all the sounds and the mixes and the beeps and the boops. And I've been here for like 4 and 5 years. And the farts. Don't forget the farts. I think it got less fun when I started getting paid to put farts in, like, on purpose. Like, I would just hide them and be like, oh, this is so funny.
Not by me.
And then one day we did an episode with Jeremy Farts, and it was like, make this one really gross. And we're going to do a behind the scenes called Anatomy of the Fart for this. And Maggie was really excited. And I'm like,
that's not fun enough.
It just lost its luster, man. It's gone.
I would have watched that. Just being
no, it was really funny though. Yeah. It was really funny. I don't do as much sound design these days. But during one of those reviews, we were sitting down, and we have a channel called Ship. And for me, coming from a games background, you know, the phrase "ship it" was a thing where it's like, hey, it's done, or it's not a bug. Ship it. We got to get it out. Get the thing out. So I saw this channel, and I'm like, all right, maybe this is the channel we go to talk about shipping projects.
Yeah, nice. Or like bringing wares over from a foreign country to here. On a slow boat.
You know, I might have guessed that. I think I guessed that second. I think I was talking like, oh, maybe this is in relation to like cargo shipments or whatever.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Oh. I don't know. And so as
Chris,
I'm saying,
the specifics were shipping bays, not just shipping. To be
oh
shipping
my god, yes,
bays.
That's right. Oh my god.
And so y'all asked me about what I thought shipping bays were, and I'm like, well, you know, where cargo ships dock or whatever.
Oh
have
my
you.
God.
Shipping bays.
I mean, docking can be involved.
Park this Big Mac in the tiny garage.
Okay, this isn't going to happen. This isn't going to happen.
Go now.
But
I got to go.
Hang on. I just had this brilliant idea, and then we should get back to this.
Okay. Hi, guys. So you're probably finding yourself in situations where you're prone to eye strain. You're watching TV. You're looking at a screen in a dark room. You're probably looking at screens more than you should during the day because that's the time that we're in right now. What's happening is that you're looking at major sources of blue light, which is phones, tablets, computers, TVs, all these electronics that you look at every single day. That's where Felix Gray comes in. They filter out 90% of the blue light in the most damaging range and eliminate 99% of glare through a proprietary industry-leading lens technology. They're hand-finished from durable, super lightweight Italian acetate. And if you order online, glasses ship directly to you with a hard case and a lens cloth included. You can try them for 30 days risk-free. If your screens aren't easier on your eyes after that, you can get them a full refund. You can get back a full refund. Go to felixgray.com/ihavenotes for the absolute best quality blue light filtering glasses on the market. That's FelixGray glasses.com/ihavenotes. Shipping and returns are totally free at Felix Gray. felixgray.com/ihavenotes. Go now.
And whenever we have our all hands for animation, Joe Clary, one of the co-heads, he always reads poetry, and it's very lovely and it's very good.
Oh no!
What do you think it would take to get him to read the lyrics to WAP? WAP.
WAP. That other word is a very different thing.
Okay, I don't know what that is. Okay, to but. WAP. What do you think it would take to get him to read the lyrics to that?
I mean, technically,
literally, send it to me. I'll put it in the notes.
<They're right now. laughs>
Oh my
I mean,
God.
Technically, Cardi B says
Poor
WAP,
Joe.
You know?
Is
like,
okay.
Betty WAP, yeah. You know what I mean?
I guess it's true.
Enough.
You can tell
fair
me
enough.
Later what it actually means.
Yeah, it's an old slur. It's an old slur.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But, well,
either way.
My ESO actually looked it up, too, yeah.
That's not how I meant it. Just being clear.
Yeah.
It's fine. This part's going to get cut. It's no big deal. So, yeah, Chris, tell us more about Baze.
So anyway, so I learned very quickly that shipping bays are not not cargo holds or places that cargo goes to and from one country. And so I got a lot of laughs out of that one from, I think it was like Maggie, Issa, Jordan, Laura. I think all four of you were in there.
It was everybody too afterwards.
And then everybody, yeah. And then since then, everybody's laughed about it. I mean, it was especially funny when Issa dropped an S2G on me, and I was like, straight to go, question mark?
Straight to, what does S2G mean?
Straight to go.
Yeah, I know what that means.
So for anyone who doesn't know, when you type in S2G, it's usually preceded with an I. So it's I swear to God.
Oh.
I think I was expressing my frustration at, like, having to do QC so many times, right?
It was like 3 or 4 in the morning.
It was very late, and I went, this is the last one, IS2G. And Chris Kikino goes, S2G? And then it was history from there.
QC is quality control.
Quality control.
If we're talking
quality
more.
Check. Yeah.
I feel like S2G is something like Batman says, like, swear to God, and then like punches somebody. Like, it's got to be
IS2G.
Yeah.
Where are the drugs, IS2G?
Don't S to G, S to STM. All right, I'm done.
Swear to me, I get it.
Yeah, swear
I
to me.
I get it. Swear.
Yeah.
So that's me. I'm still trying to figure out how to pitch a show about me learning dirty words without it being just a really, really dirty show.
I think it'd be fine if it was just a really dirty show. It'd be educational.
Yeah,
also, everyone's going to learn. Also, if you're talking about shipping bays and S2G, you're probably okay.
Yeah.
It's going to be fine. Yeah.
I think that's where it ends, though, Laura.
I could do an episode. Do you know what sounding threshold is?
Nope.
Cool. Don't look it up. We'll save it for the show.
Oh, okay. Cool. Oh, guys, I guess we made a show right now.
Yeah.
We just came up with this idea.
Do you know what docking is?
I know what that word is, yeah.
Okay.
Oh my, is this where we're going now? Did I set us up for this?
No,
I'm sorry.
I'll see if I can think of another one. I can't believe you don't know sounding.
I don't know sounding.
Yeah, really? It seems like your wheelhouse.
It seems like something I should know about, yeah.
I mean, no, it's not something I enjoy, but it's something that is funny and I've talked about before on another podcast. It's a. You can Google if you want to. Don't do it at work, though. Sam just put something in our Discord
that says
you put something in the out hole, the front one.
Oh, I know what this is.
Yep.
I've heard about this, yeah. And it's awful. It's making me hurt.
Yeah,
it's making me hurt really bad right now. Don't look this up. If you don't do it. Don't look this up.
A sound is a medical device, a rod, if you will.
Oh, no.
I believe the medical term is a pee-pee slit.
I can't say that.
Hey, hi, Laura.
I like that we both turned to Laura because it's as if she could save us from this right now.
To just start bailing. Yeah.
Yeah. Every hour, I just Slack Laura to like save
you mean
me.
55 minutes.
Yeah. Well, I'm gonna start a timer.
48.5 minutes. Yeah.
Okay, what if I did it by 48?
Laura, no. Could you please tell us what you do?
Of course. So I'm the lead producer for Ruby. Volume 8 is the first one that I'm producing. Prior to that. I was the post-producer for all of our animated content, mm-hmm. which is why I'm a part of all these stories that we're telling. Mm-hmm.
And specifically, because we use post kind of in like a couple different ways, but like specifically the editorial and audio section, which also involves color and subtitles and distribution and basically touches like every, a very similar audio. It's like
everything music and like VO.
Yeah, music, VO. I think it's fair to say that like, the editorial and audio teams are like the most like service department that we have. Like they're less show based than mm-hmm. any other department we have inside of our department.
Oh yeah. I see what you mean. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, you know, most of it, it's like, you know, okay, we're working on animation for this show. We're working on cameras for this show. But y'all touch everything.
Like literally. There's a good chance that Laura has watched like, actually everything in the animation department.
Not just a good chance, but
3 years.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, we...
Times seven.
Yeah.
Times seven, yes. Yeah, there it is.
At least. I think we're definitely, that's a very good way to put it, like in a lot of ways. Like this week alone, we're working on Death Battle, Ruby Volume 8, and some other internal projects simultaneously. Ruby D&D, which is another thing we're working on as well, which I think is like, it's neat that we're doing all these things, but it's absolutely true. We are a service house that basically just try to help focus on every project. And I think it's because our pipelines don't typically take as long as say animation or VFX and so on. So we have slightly faster turnarounds, but still pretty crazy deadlines.
I mean, it's crazy to think about too, because you guys, everyone in post involved and what Laura does now as well, as you guys, even though you don't take as long, you guys are still involved in actually every step as well, or like it seems like you guys are still involved even from like the middle of everything happening at the same time.
Yeah,
so
it's true.
I mean, y'all kind of started out with VO and animatics, and then it kind of goes off and then comes back and then goes off and comes back. So it's definitely like the hub of the production in terms of just like keeping track of like where everything's at. So, but then
it's the engine room of the ship.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Ooh,
yeah.
Well done.
Love that.
The one that we ship bays in, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, just checking. I just want to make sure. Laura. Oh my. Oh, okay.
Well.
But yeah, one of the things, the thing we're actually going to talk about is the Ruby D&D campaign a little bit. But yay. I had a thing I wanted to ask y'all about. I thought it'd be fun to ask y'all because we, you know, you haven't been on the show, so it'd be, you know, some fresh ears, minds, eyes. I want to ask y'all about hobbies. Not lobbies, but hobbies.
Hotel lobbies? Okay.
I mean, they could. Hey, whatever your proclivities are, I don't know, Chris. I don't know what your hobbies are.
Proclivities is a fun. That's a fun really, word.
That's a fun voice too, Carrie.
Yes, this is my. I'm an innkeeper in a lobby. Chris frequents here often.
Yes, I do.
Hello. Can't not hello, move my Carrie. Fingers when I talk like this.
Bring them closer, Carrie.
No.
Tickle my chin.
Yeah. So
it's my hobby at the hotel lobby, okay?
We're all, you know, we're all in the creative industry. I think, you know, our jobs, all of our jobs, like, go in and out of, you know, are we working on, like, a creative thing? Or are you working on a more production thing? How I struggle a lot, and I've been thinking about this more recently, of like having hobbies and things that are like bettering myself when like I end every day like just completely fried, and then like the weekend is just like recovering. And you know, because I'm a big fan of like I feel like having like hobbies or interests or things, you know, things that you're like researching or trying to learn, like can like make you feel better and take your mind off of like, you know, things that are stressing you out or anything like that. But like, how do you, like, do y'all have a way that you manage that? Cause I don't, or, and also just like, what are y'all hobbies? I think it's, you know, hearing about what other people do is really interesting. And especially people in this field, I feel like sometimes have unique hobbies. Mm-hmm.
Hobbies are fun
when you have time for them. Right. Mm.
Will you ever like, have time, though, or do you have to make time?
You have to make time. You have to make time for yourself. You have to say, hey, I'm going to carve out this chunk of time, regardless of what is happening in the world, and I'm going to do this thing. And unfortunately, a lot of that is, you know, you're beholden to someone else's schedule, be it if you're married or have a significant other or family, other life events. So
kids, pets.
Sometimes you can't control
two
that.
Cats,
exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Some knuckleheads.
Yeah.
But like, I think in a lot of ways for me, I've really leaned into, streaming as a hobby.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
It kind of scratches all the senses for me. I get to entertain, I get to be entertained because I'm playing games.
Mm-hmm.
I get to engage with people, especially now that we are currently on lockdown.
Mm-hmm.
And I get to tinker. I get to make this room look as good as I want it to look, because that's what I do. And it's very much so like MacGyvered, jerked to like all hell, but
it looks good.
It looks good from here.
I get to tinker. Thank you. I appreciate that. It's taken me a solid like 2.5-3 years to get it to look this good, to acquire the camera, to acquire my lights, to figure out how to get everything to look solid.
To tinker.
I like to tinker. I'm a tinker boy.
Tinker boy. That's a weird thing.
No, we're gonna scratch that. Don't use that.
Don't use it.
But yeah, so that's my thing. I think being busy is like my favorite thing.
Oh.
Which is kind of a weird, interesting weird hobby. But yeah, streaming is fun and making music.
Ooh. Sick beats.
Sick beats.
Sick beats.
What kind of beats do you throw down?
What do you
down?
Play? Yeah.
I typically play my acoustic guitar when I am making music, and I am usually playing covers of things like, you know,
Wonderwall.
Oh, hell yeah.
Sure.
Stairway to Heaven.
Oh, please, yeah.
City.
I will
city
ask you not to serenade us, but please perform for us sometime.
Yeah.
I'll try to not make it a serenade.
Chris, you can serenade me.
Thank you.
Here's the thing. Chris can serenade me.
Carrie's dream.
Yeah.
He'll be serenading me, and y'all will just be observing the serenade.
You're observing. Yes. Okay.
Passersby just watching
as
I play some Death Cab for Carrie or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
That's the band. It's Death Cab for Carrie.
Yeah.
Death Cab for, oh, I like like that one.
Yeah.
How'd you know the name of my autobiography?
I was gonna say I wrote it, but then that wouldn't be an autobiography.
That's what makes it beautiful.
Yeah, singing and playing guitar is a secondary hobby that I've been doing for about 15 years. So
I want to hear from everybody else too, real quick. But I was going to ask you as a follow up to what you're saying about you know being busy. Do you consider yourself more of an introvert or more of an extrovert?
I've decided that I am what people have considered an ambivert.
That means you eat meat, right?
Oh my God, yeah, Carrie, that's so funny.
No, it means I eat everything.
Oh, right? That's right. Okay.
Ambi, right? No, I have my times, my moments where I go out and I have fun and I can feel like I get really excited, especially when I'm hanging out with friends. But then I also have times where I'm going out and I feel completely like batteries drained.
Right.
When I do shows.
You should mention Wedding Chris.
Oh yeah, Wedding Chris.
Wedding Chris is a different person. Oh. He's my alter ego.
Your alter ego. Okay.
Is yeah, it like Chris Wedding with a K? Chris is,
well, yeah, you know what? Sure, why not?
All right.
Is K with and a party hat on one of the letters.
Yeah. Cute.
That's my South Florida version of me.
Oh my God.
I'm sorry. That pops off.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. So I'm a long answer was or short answer now, I guess, is I'm an ambivert. I like to do a little bit of everything, but sometimes I need my batteries to recharge, man. I feel it.
That's what sounding's for.
Oh my God, Carrie.
Wedding Chris is a compliment because you are an incredible dancer. So you really undersold yourself in that.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. Anyway, I have fun. I like to dance. I like to move. I'm Greek and you know, that's a big part of the culture
that
there.
Is a
so
big
I think,
thing.
We know we just like to boogie, man. We just like to have a good time.
Yeah.
Why is it that there's like, I feel like, I'm going to tangent here. I feel like a majority of people who really like identify with their culture will usually say something about how great they are or like how dancing is always a big thing. And I'm like,
not for white people.
That's what I'm saying. I'm like, wait, so.
Yeah, we don't got the groove.
Well, I'll put that down. We can pick it up for another time.
Okay.
I'd love to hear Laura's hobbies.
That was Issa saying, like, nope, Carrie's going to take this in a bad place.
I don't want to think about that right now.
Okay, we'll get back to this later. Later. way later.
Sam, if you want to write that down to cut.
Yeah, no, that was a super easy lead-in. Yeah.
So Laura, what are some of your hobbies?
So I have to say most of my hobbies are things that are very different now that we're in quarantine. And so a lot of what I do now is I try to find a corollary, you know? So things that I used to love, what can I do now that's kind of similar? So examples, I used to see every movie ever in theaters. And I can't anymore, and there aren't as many new movies, but I try to watch movies that are new to me constantly.
Okay.
Music shows. I go to see a lot of live music, you know, we're in Austin and I really miss being able to do that, but I can't. So instead I'll order a record that I've never heard before and just listen to it all the way through like a show, you know? So I kind of recreate the experience and I like to take a lot of hikes or like nature walks or walk through gardens. And while I can still, you know, take hikes and do that a little bit, I've actually started growing more plants to try to bring that into my home because I'm not always as comfortable being out. And games. I love board games. I'm a tabletop game player, like to the end. That's what I love to do. But because I can't get together with groups, I'm getting a lot more into video games than I used to be. So that's really what I've been doing is just, I don't know, trying to find the new version of things that I already love that I can do now.
That's good. You're not letting the Rona stop you.
Yeah.
So far, no. Yeah.
That's so interesting and awesome because I think for me, like a lot of my hobbies, like when people ask me like, well, how are you doing like in quarantine? I'm like, you know, I miss people. Like I miss people a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But like a lot of my hobbies are still pretty much the things I already do.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of like what you, like your breakdown, Laura, of like all your hobbies is really neat, because it sounds like you're doing a really nice mishmash or mix of indoor-outdoor activities.
Discovering something.
And yeah, finding things that make you happy. And I think that that's important. I think I kind of lost my way, and this is kind of an interesting revelation for me, but I kind of like have lost my way in terms of like what makes me truly happy. And I think that it's it could be a byproduct of doing too much of the same thing,
right? I get that.
Oh yeah,
being indoors and playing the same games and do this stuff brings me momentary happiness. But I think at the end of the day, like finding the thing that you can do to enjoy both indoor and outdoor. Because I mean, we need to be outdoor. We are creatures that are made to at least experience some level of
disagree. But go ahead.
Carrie, you need that vitamin D.
Yeah, I drink milk.
What?
Vitamin D. Milk has vitamin D in it.
Big D stands for big demeanor, Carrie.
Wait. Does it actually have vitamin D in it?
I'm pretty sure. Yeah, milk's like a great source of vitamin
D. I thought it was calcium
and vitamin C, but maybe I'm
wrong. No,
that's orange juice, idiot.
Vitamin C is fruits. You're right. Yeah. Vitamin D.
Milk. All right. Vitamin D. First thing.
Like I said,
I'm a rock.
Crimbo.
Also, I just want to call out like Chris saying something really earnest and like that he really cares about and feels, and then everyone just immediately crapping on
him. Yeah, I'm sorry, Chris.
Yeah, this is basically every episode of every show I'm ever on, so it's fine.
You get dunked that's on
my,
a little bit.
That's my.
You,
that's
you
my
do.
Role.
You get a little dunked.
It's out of love, though.
Look, I'm 5'6". It's easy to dunk on me, man. I can't even reach the bottom of the net, so we're good.
Yeah, what's it like being 5'6" and not 5'7"?
Yeah, Carrie.
Or 5'6½" like me.
I appreciate
that. Yeah, 5'7" on a good day.
I appreciate that Laura's the tallest one out of all of us.
Yeah.
I'm the one out of advantage. I'm
almost 5'10".
Yeah, I get those good hugs. I miss hugging you, Laura.
I miss hugging you too. I actually thought about that the other day. I went to get a glass of water and I thought like if I was in the office in the kitchen getting water, Issa would be hugging me.
It's true.
That was anyway. Yeah,
that's why I've started collecting body pillows of everybody in the office.
Oh, that's why, Carrie.
So then I can hug them.
Doing it.
Okay. No. Yeah. That's fine. Mm. That's normal.
I'm not uncomfortable at all.
Oh my God.
Hey, I'm in danger. I feel like I'm in danger down here. Below
well,
Carrie.
Just so you know, your body pillow is not in danger. I'm going to keep him very safe. Don't worry, Chris.
Listen, Issa, Laura, just stay on like on that side over there. It's okay. I'll protect you.
Okay.
Yeah. He's mine now.
Oh, my.
I am seriously thinking about like, I feel like when, you know, we get like a vaccine, like basically when we know that we're safe again, like handshakes and like just seeing people is going to be replaced with hugs in the office. Like
hug party.
The first like month back, it's going to be like, oh, hey, Chris, what's up? Let me talk to you about this thing real quick. And then like, we'll hug and then talk about
and then
it.
You'll talk about Man, it and you'll whisper hey, each other's ear about
yeah.
it.
Listen, I'm, like I said, I'll say it again. I'm Greek. I already do that shit.
That's
yeah,
true.
Exactly.
That's true.
I'm like, I love,
you
I mean,
do.
It's always
you're a hugger.
Consensual hugs only.
Yes.
But if you're down for hugs, I am there to give you like a big old hug. And then, you know, we're going to catch up, talk about your family.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you how to make some tzatziki.
I'll sneak it behind you, Chris,
Ooh.
And hug you. You don't even know I'm there.
And then
I've been
Carrie
practicing.
Inadvertently be part of the conversation.
Yeah. Chris will be talking to somebody. I'll just sneak up like,
and
hey, what's up,
like,
bud? How's
hey,
it going?
What's up, guys? Hey, can I listen?
Hey, guys.
I won't. I'm going to keep my hands to myself.
So to get back to it.
Hugging's my hobby.
Hugging's my hobby. I actually really like the way that you're going about finding things to do in terms of your hobbies, Laura, because I think that's actually a really smart way to go about it. And Chris, I think you hit on something that I do intrinsically believe in, which is kind of like, oh, you are doing the same thing over and over again. So it is kind of just, I think at what point is something that you really love, at what point does that feel like a chore sometimes, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's also, something I've come across in terms of like growing up, drawing used to be my hobby, but now it's my job. So there's that big, not disconnect, but it is like kind of this has evolved into something that I have this attitude about, where now even like if family, I'm definitely that person who will not look happy if a family member asks me if they can draw, if I can draw something for them, you know. It is not like, something
fine, pay me.
Yeah, it's pretty much, you know, and I sound like a huge brat, and it is not something I derive a lot of joy out of anymore, because it's a really, it's one of those things. I think a lot of artists I know have that like same attitude, like the same feelings towards it. It's kind of just like this conflicting idea. But Laura, I think the way that you go about it is like, it is both new and old at the same time. And I think that's really pleasant. I really like that.
Mm-hmm. I think one of the things, or Issa, what are your hobbies?
I actually would consider buying paper craft kits and putting them together a hobby.
Those are like two separate things.
At it too. buying them and doing them.
I mean, buying them, researching which ones you want. That's a hobby. I'm serious.
Shopping is my hobby.
Yeah.
But I think for me, I realize I derive a lot of pleasure from just following a set of instructions. If I'm looking at something to like turn my brain off, that is actually the best way. It's just kind of like dumbing down something so I don't have to really think about it as hard. And then that is something I actually kind of enjoy spending time on. Even if it feels a little like useless, isn't that what some hobbies are sometimes? I don't know.
That's okay. So that's what I was going to ask, because I think that's part of like the core of like kind of like a problem I have a lot is this whole show is like Carrie has a problem. Can everybody help solve it?
I love that show.
My favorite.
So to me, like if you asked me, Carrie, what are your hobbies? I play video games. Mm-hmm. I'll read sometimes. Mm. I am learning Japanese, which I think is kind of a hobby.
It's 100% a hobby.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And I like messing around with like, you know, I don't get to do it very often, but like, you know, like old, like changing out the shell of a Game Boy and like, basically like messing with like a Raspberry Pi, like, you know, like, like tech tinkering. Project stuff. I like to tinker.
Oh no. Yeah,
the fingers again, comes. The tinker fingers.
Tinker fingers.
These are my tinker fingers. Like something about saying the phrase tinker fingers. I feel like if I just mess up like one syllable, I'm offending somebody.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, it's really,
I don't even know what
you're
it would be.
There. You're teetering on that edge.
Yeah. I don't, I can't even think about what it would be, but it seems like it would be anyways. But so I have this weird thing where, yeah, to me, like doing stuff more like along the lines of like playing video games or like building a model kit. To me, hobbies are more successful for me in terms of like relaxing. If like, yeah, if I'm completely turning my brain off. Mm-hmm, right. Mm-hmm, and, but I do, then I feel that guilt of cool. I built this model kit. I could have spent all that time
doing
practicing vocabulary or like finally getting into Blender more.
Yeah.
And it's not that I don't also enjoy those other things, but they are work also.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, they are.
So it's like, maybe, I mean, part of it is just like being okay with like wasting time. I think video games are like the closest for me where I can play a video game and, you know, I think there's an argument made of like, okay, well, I got story out of it. Mm-hmm. You know, video games have always been a passion of mine. It'd be cool to work on one day. So it's like, okay, well, that's a little bit more like knowledge now. Mm-hmm. And I enjoyed the time doing it, but I could have also probably not done it. And I would be mostly the same person. Mm-hmm. I don't know. It's like, I get that guilt. That's my problem. I got a lot of guilt.
You can't guilt yourself with that, man. Go ahead, Laura.
No, I'm going to enter a new hobby, which is helping support Carrie until you understand that doing things that you enjoy for
like
yourself
I'm here for
is
that.
Not a waste of time. Aww. It's an important use of time.
Yeah.
100%.
I appreciate
100%.
It. 100%. The problem I have, though, half the time, too, is like, and this is one of the things I was going to ask y'all about is like, okay, we're going to finish recording this, a little peek behind the curtain. We're going to finish recording this by about 8:00. You know, I've got, call it 2.5 hours before I need to start trying to go to sleep or the next day is going to be useless. all I want to do is just sit on the couch and do nothing. That's all I want to do. But if that's all I ever do, I'm not going to like better myself, or I'm not even going to like relax. I'm just going to kind of like veg out.
Listen, you know, this is one of the most important things I've ever learned from my father, from my friends, my family, my therapist. You have to be loving and accepting of yourself for who you are and the things that your body is telling you that you need to do. But you also need to find balance, right? If you every day come home from work and you're like, I got to fix that crack in the ceiling. Got to fix that. You think about it every day.
There is a crack in my ceiling, Chris.
There's a crack in everyone's ceiling. We live in Texas. It's always hot. Yeah. That's true. Everything's settling. It's awful. The point is, though, is that you have to be accepting of the fact that, like, balance is key. Maybe after this, if you spend 30 minutes doing one thing that you think might better you a little bit, and then spend the other 2 hours of your evening getting lost in whatever game you're going to play, or putting together, you know, Game Boy cartridges or Game Boys as a whole, or whatever it is you want to do that brings you some sense of joy, you should do that, because we have such limited time on this planet, and you should not spend any time of your days overly worrying about that shit. Like, let that shit go, dude. Like, no one's asking to become the best at any of those things. You don't have to be like some kind of, you know, person who just gets lost in learning Japanese and, oh, now I'm the best person in, you know, the world that can speak this particular language. Like, you don't have to spend all this time getting into that. Like, little by little, no one has any expectations of you. This is for you and for you alone. And I think that we set such high bars for ourselves that we effectively get in our own heads about it. So whenever this is done, go do whatever you have to do for 30 minutes, or break for a little bit and then do that thing for 30 minutes and then fuck off for like the rest of the evening, dude. Like,
I'm gonna cry. So
one, I completely agree with what you just said, Chris. Two, are you willing to share the shirt or no shirt game that you play with your dad?
Oh,
because what I am
segue.
I am not. No. I'm not making light. It actually lends a lot of credence to his advice because he's such a genuine person.
What a fucking segue. I love this. You credence to my advice or to my father's advice?
Both. Yes.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Okay. All right. Wow. What a left turn, Laura. I'm not prepared, but here we go.
He's not prepared,
Let's roll. Okay, so Shirt or No Shirt is a game that I play with my very, let's just say, very handsome 55-year-old Greek father.
Oh my God.
Is he a himbo? Very...
But with better advice.
Okay. A sage-like himbo
who now apparently has like a six-pack. He's been like kicking ass.
Oh my God, Dad.
Yeah. So my pops lives in Florida, and we play this game every time we go out. Well, when we used to go out drinking, maybe we'll do it on like a Zoom call one of these days. But where I would FaceTime my father, and everybody would in the group would guess shirt or no shirt.
Oh my God.
And the idea, if you don't get it thus far, is I'm gonna FaceTime my dad and everyone's betting on whether or not he is or is not wearing a shirt.
Oh, that's my very God.
And
has it ever
I'm
been
pretty
shirt?
Sure like one or two times, and the one time, no, it's only been a few times, right? And one of those few times was when he was out at a restaurant with my stepmom. And I kid you not, New Year's, that was another time. He was out with my stepmom for dinner and FaceTiming him, and I got all these people behind me and they're all cheering. Yeah, and he goes to start taking his shirt off. And it's
oh
like,
my God.
At a restaurant, and my stepmom's like, honey, no. And she's like pulling his shirt down.
That's the crazy. Best.
I love my pops. He's a good dude.
What a guy.
Yeah. It's very endearing.
If he gives advice through you, I will listen to it for sure.
I'm a conduit for my shirtless father. Weird sentence.
Yeah.
I'm a conduit for my shirtless father's advice. There we go. That's a way better way to put that. Woof.
Well, what this episode of this podcast has turned into is less of us talking about the D&D campaign and more why you should watch it, because these two amazing people are on it as well, and they're very funny and good people. We should probably talk about that, or everyone will be mad at us. So yeah, this when you're okay, it's the it comes out on the 15th. So when you're watching this, if you're it'll almost be out.
Oh, true.
It'll almost be out.
Two days.
A day or two from after this. Yeah, the Ruby the Grim campaign comes out. It features myself, Laura, Chris, and Chad, James.
Playing.
Yeah, Chad. Eddie is DMing, and it's a series based in the Ruby world. You know, there's gonna be some clues in there for y'all of like when it's going on. So I'll let y'all discover it. But yeah, if you go to our Twitters, you can see the our characters that we put out. We've already recorded some episodes. It's really fun. I really look forward to playing every week because it's just like.
Oh, that's so nice.
Very refreshing.
Yeah. It's been neat. Yeah. It's been neat to see how everybody's like adapting to their characters.
Yeah.
Especially just so Chad's never played before, which is really cool.
Yeah. Like, oh, really?
Chad's never played before.
Which is
super surprising.
I've never played a campaign that lasted more than like 3 games.
Nice.
And Eddie's never DM'd before. Yeah. Laura's like a D&D expert, and Chris, Chris, you also know what's up. so it's been a good mix, but like just me being in it, like I've had so much fun, and I feel like we all really care about our characters, which is cool to see like how quickly that happened. You know, so
I'm so excited to watch it.
Yeah, we would appreciate
too,
if you check it out.
Mark. I'm like, she's excited. I said, me too, question mark. And I'm like, I've never watched myself play D&D before, but I'm like,
are you afraid?
I'm still not going to watch myself play D&D.
I hate watching myself on camera.
Don't. That's what I do.
But I want to see it play out. I want to see how it works.
I know.
And also, I have to watch it because we're doing audio for it. But conversation.
You do. Thank you, by the way.
Yeah.
Thanks to Jake Kamita.
Yeah, Jake. No, I've already decided I'm not going to watch it till we're done filming because I just want to play the game and have fun and be in the moment and not, you know, think about it beyond that. So.
Yeah.
It's been so much fun, though.
No matter how much we've all played D&D or not or DM'd or not, I mean, this is our first D&D show that we're doing. So, you know, bear with us.
We're learning.
It's been a lot of fun. Yeah, we're doing some really cool stuff with Talespire. Which is this like 3D program that was kickstarted that kind of like lets like build out your world and your characters and like act out. So especially for like action, it's been really awesome. And they were super cool and got some like custom Grim models like in the game.
It's amazing for us. It's super.
It's really cool.
Wow.
It's so cool. I mean, the way that my brain works, like I love to do the theater, the mind stuff, but I also being able to see where everyone exists in a plane is just, it's so helpful. Yeah. And it's, I don't know, there's just, now that everything we do is digital, this is a way to do it that actually feels the same as tabletop gaming.
And that's cool.
Yeah.
It's fun. Yeah.
Yeah. We've had like a good mix of like kind of doing both. And I definitely like both, but like there's something very cool about like, all of a sudden seeing a Grim like on screen like that, you know.
Wow. When we saw that model pop in there, it was like it went off. Yeah. It was really cool.
Even if they're huge.
They are
yeah.
And even if it was spooky. Some people go in the wrong direction, I won't say who or why or when.
What?
Ooh, foreshadowing.
What?
I'm just saying there might be a particular episode where
one goes in the wrong direction.
You might think maybe one person has an idea. We'll see. But yeah.
So did you want to take a moment to talk about the characters at all? Just a brief glimpse into the characters.
Yeah, we could. I'm an anime boy. Who are y'all?
Well, wow, really succinct.
That's it. That's it.
I like that. I'm a big furry himbo. There you go. That's me. Yeah. Big furry himbo at your service.
Nice.
Who's your character?
I love them.
Phoenix. Oh no, I was saying that like that's you, but who's your character?
Yeah, I got it after I was like, I genuinely going to give you the answer.
Yeah, he did. Yeah.
And then I was like, I understand. Really, now.
That's how you know a joke's good when no one gets it.
When
It hit me like seconds later.
Laura, what's your succinct summary?
Sure. Yeah, my character is Arastra Sky, and she's a faunus who is smart and so strong, not great with people.
Doesn't put up with shit.
Oh, nope.
Yeah.
Nope.
She's kind of me, but a little bit stronger and meaner, and I love her. It's a great character.
She is delightful.
I definitely feel like we all put a little bit of ourselves into this.
Yeah, yeah, that's like, it makes sense. It's the base you start with, and then you, you know, grow from there. But yeah,
it's funny because as soon as I pitched my character to Laura, Laura's like, "So you mean it's you?" And I'm like, yes. Which is funny because I typically play more charismatic characters. I typically play like bards and such.
You don't think you're like charismatic, Crisco?
Like me as a human being?
Yeah.
You as a bear? Like what? Oh, yeah, of course you're a human being.
I'm a lion. Take it easy.
Yeah.
Oh, I see what you did there.
I was just saying, I also realized bear could mean something else too. I just meant as, anyways.
Oh, Carrie.
You're not a bear. You're more of an otter.
I think I'm a...
Am I wrong? I am too.
Do the zoom in thing, Chris. Do you...
I don't know if it's set. I don't know if it's in the right place. It's probably not in the right place.
Otters unite.
Oh, it is.
Oh, all of my information about that comes from that one episode of Always Sunny, so I'm just assuming.
I think as a person, as a human being, I think I consider myself fairly charismatic, but I think what I'm kind of going for here is my character is not charismatic, my character now. So my bards are usually more in line with me as a person, I think, but this guy is a little bit more of an angry boy.
Angry.
A little upset. And when he gets upset, well, I guess we'll just have to see what happens.
I guess we'll have to find out. But yeah, that's August 15th. If you're listening to this when it comes out, that's a day or two away. If you're listening to this episode on the 16th, that's a day ago. Go watch it.
If you're listening to this in 2048, then it came out 28 years ago.
And you can find out more about your president and how he enacted...
Our new concept of time.
38 hour days.
I hate it.
Oh my God.
I hate it so much.
Who knows how long the episodes will be? 30 minutes, an hour and a half? What time scale? Who knows? I actually don't know how long the first episode is. I think that's going to wrap it up on this episode of I Have Notes. As always, please, 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 if you wouldn't mind commenting, liking, sharing, whatever makes sense for the platform that you're watching on, we would appreciate it. Also, as always, go watch Recorded by RSL, please.
Everyone do that, please. Immediately.
It's
the best.
Thank you, guys.
Everybody embarrass Issa. And also wish Issa a happy birthday.
It's so good. Happy birthday in this video.
Yeah.
Happy birthday in this video.
You have to watch this part on your birthday again, so then it'll meet us actually.
So it makes sense.
I will ask Sam specifically to cut this part out so that we can just share it on social on the day of my birth.
If you're watching this, share your hobbies with us. Ooh. Tell us what you like to do.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
I would love to hear that.
I love that.
Maybe we can all learn from each other. Throw in hashtag I have notes on it. Tweet at us. Tell us about your hobbies. And tell us how you do your hobbies. That makes sense.
Shirt off.
It does. Yeah, it does.
Yeah. And that's the sign that this is the end of the episode. So thank you all very much and have a good week. Bye.